Welcome. Grab your favorite morning beverage and join us for Morning Cannolis with Jim Santel.
You don't know me, but I'm your brother.
Sampling the news desserts of the week, here is your host, Jim Santel.
Good morning. This is Morning Cannolis. It is Saturday, September 17th. I am delighted once again to have you join me for this hour and next hour as well as we talk about law and government and the aspiration for justice in America. Delighted to have you with me. I am here in the studios of WAUK Waukesha, downtown Waukesha, Wisconsin. My producer this morning, as always, Kelvin, is joining me. And we'll be taking your phone calls, your comments, your questions throughout these 2 hours of this morning of Morning Cannolis at 844-967-2789. That number once again, 844-967-2789. Morning Cannolis. We're talking this morning about more topical issues important to the life and the livelihood of our nation, our state, and our community. It is the 260th day of 2022. We have 105 more days yet to go. We've got an aggressive but achievable syllabus, a curriculum for you again this morning. Let me identify, let me tell you what that's going to be all about. We'll spend some time initially, as we always do, talking about this day in history and spending a little time talking about why this is an especially important day and especially important anniversary in the history of America and our Constitution itself. Many of you probably know what that is all about, what happened on September 17th in the history of the United States of America. We'll talk about some other events equally important in our nation and our world also happening on September 17th in the times of our lives. Then we're going to go back and do some updates of things we've been chatting a lot about in the past several days, including just yesterday. I had the great honor, the great pleasure of sitting in for Mike Crute for Devil's Advocates programming throughout the afternoon and talked again about these decisions being made by a federal district court judge in South Florida that are affecting quite dramatically the impact, the progress of the investigation into the documents seized at Mar-a-Lago, the residence and resort of the former president way back in early August. What's the status of that? We chatted a lot about that yesterday afternoon. We have had some updates on that news story even since we went off the air yesterday afternoon. About 12 hours or so ago, late last night, the United States Department of Justice did something very significant in the further pursuit of this investigation. We're going to update you on exactly what that is, what that means. We're going to talk about the special master appointed by Judge Eileen Connor Cannon, coming out of South Florida as well. We'll chat about all of those issues just to update you. And then our principal focus this morning, this hour and into much of the second hour, this morning on Morning Cannolis, is going to be talking about the U.S. Department of Justice. The reason why it is important for a Justice Department in America, and I would offer for any republic on the face of the planet, to be independent of politics, to be apolitical, nonpartisan as it pursues its all-important work, its roles in investigating crimes, in defending and prosecuting civilly claims of the United States of America, of the people of this nation. Why is it important that that not be done with a partisan bias or a political bent in any of those pursuits? Why is it important in particular for the United States Department of Justice, including the Attorney General, the political people who are appointed to the Department of Justice and throughout the U.S. Attorney's offices, to be independent of the White House, to be making decisions that are not premised upon any undue influence or attempts to influence in inappropriate ways the prosecution decisions, criminal litigation, civil litigation decisions being made by your United States Department of Justice, responsible in this country for administering the rule of law, ensuring that the Constitution is upheld and that the rule of law is paramount. Why is that important? And why are we talking about that this morning? A couple of very important stories just this past week. We're going to be chatting a lot this morning about a book that was just recently released this past week by Jeff Berman, who is the former U.S. attorney in Southern New York. He released a book called Holding the Line, in which he recounts a great number of events, circumstances in the Trump administration during which that line was crossed. The line was even erased. Attempts by the Department of Justice to do certain things with respect to the prosecutions out of the U.S. Attorney's Office in Southern New York. Attempts by the White House to influence those decisions as well. I'm going to talk to you about three particular instances that Jeff Berman, now in private practice once again, describes that happened in his administration of justice, his attempts to do so without partisan intervention, unsuccessful and unsuccessful during the course of his term as the presidentially appointed U.S. attorney, ultimately resulting in his firing, not by the attorney general, but by the president himself for presumably failing to abide by the wishes and the inclinations of the former president Donald Trump. We're going to talk a lot about that. We're also going to talk about a related story that is coming up again for consideration, for attention by the country, and that is the work of a fellow named John Durham, former U.S. attorney in Connecticut, continuing on under the Biden and Garland administration to investigate the investigation of Russia and its involvement in the 2016 election. We'll talk about some events going to be happening in October, next month of this year, and then also reminiscing a little bit, talking a little bit about the successes and, frankly, non-activity, non-successes of the so-called Durham initiatives, this attempt to try to figure out whether or not the investigation of Russian intervention in the 2016 election, whether that was legitimate. We'll talk about how that came about, what the involvement of the former Attorney General William Barr was, and what we know has come of the so-called Durham investigation and what has not come of it, principally things that have not happened as a result of that investigation, the reasons for it, and then circling back again to talk about the reasons why these accounts of attempts, some of them successful, some of them not, to influence justice, to skew, if you will, the course of the rule of law in America are so, so very critical, not only to understand, but to avoid in the future. What are the lessons that we learn from these stories coming out just this week, a part of our recent history? But before we get to all of that, let's do some work on what happened today in history. I'm going to begin with a number of things that go back, way back to 1778. 1778 on September 17th was the day that the United States of America recently formed in creation, if you will, first negotiated a formal treaty between itself, between the United States government and a Native American Indian tribe. They were the Delaware Nation of Native Americans, and the treaty, one of many, obviously, that followed in the years, decades, and frankly, even century that followed, with a very checkered history, as we well know, not one of America's brighter spots in its history with respect to its relationship, treaties being made and broken by the United States government, even the subject of recent Supreme Court cases coming out of that high court. This particular treaty negotiated between the United States and the Delaware Nation at the Monongahela and Allegheny Rivers. You can see that treaty. It is on display at the National Museum of the American Indian in Washington, D.C., a place to visit when you are on the Mall in Washington, D.C. I suspect many of you have been there. An important time in our nation's history. The first treaty ever negotiated with a Native American Indian tribe in our nation's history. As we know, our Native American tribes continue to be national treasures and also independent nations inside our government, an issue that continues to be a subject of an awful lot of wrestling inside the judiciary and inside attempts to understand both our history and our current relationship with our all-important Native American populations here in the United States of America. That a singular important event on September 17th in our nation's history. What else happened on September 17th? 1849. Harriet Tubman. You all know Harriet Tubman well from history books and from the important role that she has played in our nation's movement toward a better and more equal nation for all of us. Harriet Tubman, 1849. This is the day she escaped from her southern plantation where she had been enslaved. For many years she escaped. She headed north, and you know the rest of the history. Over time, over many days, months, and years, she eventually developed and created and managed the Underground Railroad, which
provided access to and freedom for many, many slaves seeking to escape their slavehood in the southern parts of our nation at that time. 1849, Harriet Tubman escaping from her plantation and her slavery, beginning once again to change American history. A few years later, 1862, the Civil War is underway at that time. Union forces on 1862, September 17th, the forces halted the Confederate advance in Maryland in one of the most significant battles of the Civil War. That's the Battle of Antietam. 26,000 people lost their lives at that battle, one of the bloodiest in the entire Civil War. Again, began to affect not only the course of that war, but eventually led to, of course, to the Union victory in the course of the Civil War. One of the bloodiest events, 26,000 people killed, soldiers on both sides of the Union and the Confederacy on that day, this day in 1862. Other significant events, 1978, jumping ahead quite a bit. 1978, the Camp David Accords. I suspect many of you were alive and remember that well. Camp David Accords, President Jimmy Carter, our president at that time, brought together two world leaders. Her name was Anwar Sadat from Egypt, the president of Egypt, later assassinated in Egypt. He was the leader of Egypt at the time. And Menachem Begin, who was the prime minister of Israel at that time. Egypt and Israel, of course, for many, many years, centuries actually, both prior to and following the creation of the Israeli state in the Middle East, were enemies and were warring, and the history of that is well known. Cyrus Vance, who was the Secretary of State at that time, and Jimmy Carter, our president, brought them together at Camp David. They signed the Camp David Accords on September 17th, 1978. Those accords, this basic outline for an understanding for peace between these two historically warring nations, Egypt and Israel, led ultimately to the establishment of a peace treaty the following year, remains to this day an important issue, an important event in the history of the Middle East. Beyond that, 1991 was the day on September 17th that North Korea and South Korea were both admitted to the United Nations. And finally on 2011, on September 17th, the first Occupy Wall Street protest was held in Manhattan, protesting income inequality, corporate greed, fiscal improprieties, all those kinds of things happening on this day in 2011. Right after the break, we'll talk about the single most important anniversary here on Morning Cannolis. Join us at 844-967-2789. Back. This is Jim Santel. It is Morning Cannolis. Our discussion today of law, government, and the aspiration for justice in America. We're doing what we traditionally do this morning, and that is talking about significant events that happened in the history of America and our world on the particular day that we broadcast this morning. Of course, Saturday, September 17th. I have saved perhaps not the most important, but arguably one of the best anniversaries of all. September 17th, many, many years ago, was this day on September 17th that the Constitution of the United States of America, 1787, was signed by 39 delegates who were meeting, as you well know, in Philadelphia. They had attempted, they and others, to create a new nation in the wake of the Revolutionary War through the establishment of a document, a creation of government called the Articles of Confederation, established a very, very weak national government and basically was a tie of the colonies, the new states in America, was not successful for a number of reasons, including the fact that the Articles of Confederation didn't provide funding for the new government, didn't provide a strong structure for ensuring that it could operate and bring together our nation. And so reconvened our delegates in Philadelphia to talk about the creation of a new document, a new way of thinking about America. And that's exactly what they did for many, many days and weeks, talked about a new document that would bring us all together. Ultimately, that document, of course, the Constitution of the United States of America. 39 delegates, as I said, in Philadelphia.
And on this particular day, after a lot and lot of discussion about the mechanisms through which that document we put together, its content, signed the Constitution. Didn't make it effective that day, but it was the day on which it was signed by the delegates. The commemoration of today as Constitution Day and also Citizenship Day, a day that we recognize also those people who have become citizens and who continue to be citizens of America. The commemoration actually had its origin way back in 1940 when the Congress passed a joint resolution authorizing and requesting the president to make a proclamation setting aside what was then the third Sunday for the public recognition of everyone who had attained the status of American citizenship. And the designation for that day at the time in 1940 was I Am an American Day. And because of the popularity of that, gained a lot of support both in the states of the Union and frankly throughout the world. In 1944, William Randolph Hearst sponsored a 16-minute film called I Am an American, and it was featured in American theaters and became a top news story at the time. And with about 5 years after that, 48 states issued state proclamations making it a national holiday. 1952, Congress passed a new resolution, a new law, moving the date from that time in May to September 17th, its present day, to commemorate, as they said at the time, the formation and the signing on September 17th, 1787, of the Constitution of the United States of America. That day was still also designated as Citizenship Day and retained this initial purpose, this original purpose of recognizing everyone who had attained American citizenship. So both of those things acknowledged and recognized on September 17th of 1787. Important today because it's also a significant time for civics education. As a part of all of these resolutions and laws that have passed in the federal government, state government, recognizing the importance of September 17th, many of those Congresses, many of those state legislatures have said this should also be a time for re-educating America on civics. And one of the resolutions talked about the complete instruction of citizens in their responsibilities and opportunities as citizens of the United States and of the state and localities in which they reside. Very important commission for Constitution Day and also Citizenship Day, which we celebrate today. Important part of our culture. Cultural heritage in the United States of America. Again, September 17th, the day of the signing of the Constitution. As we know, it took a little while for all the requisite number of states to endorse and to sign off on the Constitution. But today is a day that we generally regard as the birth of our Constitution, September 17th, 1787. Appropriate then to talk about things deriving from our Constitution this morning. Laws that are premised upon it ultimately as the supreme law of the land. I indicated before the break that we would be doing a little bit of an update on at least one of the results of the Constitution, that is the establishment of an executive branch that includes the U.S. Department of Justice, the creation of a federal judiciary that includes federal district court judges in places around the country, district court judges, appellate court judges, and of course also a Congress, and all that coming from the Constitution. We know that because of what people like James Madison, George Mason, others did in 1787 and the years that followed as the first Congress convened, we have courts today that do in fact make important decisions. We've got an executive branch, including a United States Department of Justice that routinely investigates cases, as it is investigating to this time the acquisition, the seizure in early August, August 8th, of about 11,000 documents at the former president's location in Mar-a-Lago, South Florida. And we know well that during the course of the last several weeks, Judge Eileen Cannon, who is a federal district court judge in South Florida, has issued a number of rulings in connection with the oversight of that investigation, actually coming out of a civil case, not the criminal matter itself, which has not been charged yet, but a civil case brought by the former president, challenging things along the way, challenging in many ways the conduct, the further pursuit of the investigation of those documents seized, including about
100 of them identified by the government as being classified in nature, arguably providing information to whoever may have seen them about our national security and perhaps the national security of other nations out there. So we know great numbers of orders coming out of the Federal District Court, including a decision by the judge, Eileen Cannon, to appoint a special master. And yes, just this past week, as you well know, Judge Eileen Cannon indicated that she will, in fact, appoint a special master, which she has done. I'm going to talk about him in just a moment or so, described what his duties and responsibilities are. But she also, along the way, declined to rescind a previous decision that she had made, basically to stop the government from looking at about 100 sensitive documents, these classified documents that were taken from former President Donald Trump's residence in Florida. And as a result of the judge's decision to continue with that prohibition, even as she is appointing a special master to look at all these documents, just last night, probably about 12 hours ago, the United States Department of Justice, yes, led by the Attorney General Merrick Garland, asked an appeals court to let the FBI regain access to about 100 sensitive documents, pursue this appeal to the United States Court of Appeals of the 11th Circuit, cases coming out of Alabama, Georgia, and Florida. All of those things happening. We're going to talk more about that right after the break. Stay with us on Morning Cannolis here at WAUK in Waukesha. This is Jim Santel, Morning Cannolis, talking right now about this late-breaking news coming out of Washington, D.C., coming out of South Florida, coming out of the 11th Circuit just last night. The United States Department of Justice appealing the previous decision of Judge Eileen Cannon to appoint a special master and, most specifically, to prevent the Department of Justice from proceeding with its investigation, its review, about 100 sensitive documents, classified documents taken from the residence and the resort of the former president. Along the way, the United States Department of Justice says this in its 29-page appeal, its filing just last night. It says, although the government believes the district court fundamentally erred, made this mistake in appointing a special master and granting injunctive relief, basically to the former president, the government, that is the United States Department of Justice, seeks to withhold further action only on the portions of Judge Cannon's order causing the most serious and immediately harm to the government and the public. In that ruling, as I said, she had not only appointed a special master, but also indicated that the investigation needed to be suspended. The department's filing last night describes the request as modest, not everything they could do, but critically important, in their words, said that the government and the public would suffer irreparable harm absent a suspension of what Judge Cannon has done, because efforts to fully understand the effects of the haphazard storage of documents bearing classification markings could not proceed unless the lower court's decision was at least partially reversed. This is a partial appeal, again, from the district court to the 11th Circuit. It's a court of appeals, one of 13 courts of appeals in our nation. This particular circuit covers the states of Alabama, Georgia, and Florida. It is located, it's venued in Atlanta. It was created back in 1981, carved out from a much larger Fifth Circuit, which continues to exist. And the court of appeals, where the government will now be appealing, arguing this matter, exists in Atlanta. It's at the Elbert U.S. Court of Appeals building. That building, for what it is worth, important, significant naming of that building, after Chief Judge, Circuit Judge Elbert Tuttle, who was in the 1960s the leader of that court. Many, many decisions coming from this distinguished jurist, advancing civil rights at the time. And so this matter now up on appeal to the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit. And so more to talk about. And for that purpose, let's take a couple of callers who have called in.
Mark, let's begin with you from Prairie du Sac. Your comment or question this morning about things we've already chatted about, perhaps including this latest action out of South Florida and Washington, D.C.
Well, what's ridiculous to me is that Donald Trump stole those documents from Washington, D.C. and transported them to another location. So you could actually go and say, well, you know, that why is it, you know, this decision being made out of Florida? Because the crime was committed when he took those documents from Washington, D.C. in the first place.
Sure. Lots of places, right, for jurisdiction here. The lawsuit itself, again, filed by the former president, he happened to choose South Florida for various reasons. But you're right. The crime itself, if it is in fact determined to be a crime, it's a crime against America, right? And against everyone who regards the Constitution as being meaningful and specifically concerned about the safety and security of our nation. But go ahead. You had another point to make, I suspect,
yeah,
Mark.
The other point I'd make is that it seems that so many, and it's important on this time when we're remembering the Constitution, that there are parties out there that want to rewrite the Constitution, not just make amendments to the Constitution. They want to take it and rewrite it out of whole cloth. And Hamilton addressed that in his closing in the Federalist Papers, how there are people who are opposed to a national government, and that in any possible shape. And I mean, he dreaded the consequences of trying to redo the entire Constitution. I mean, he thought it was a horrible thing. And these people have taken an oath, all these politicians have taken an oath to uphold the Constitution of the United States, including Judge Cannon down there in Florida. And her lack of understanding, I mean, my question is why me, a provincial boy from far northern Wisconsin, who just got a degree in accounting, I don't have a law degree, but I mean, how I have a better understanding of what the law actually means than a person who was appointed to the federal bench is scary to me. Do they just understand it, or did she just want to ignore it because it's politically expedient and that's their political philosophy? And, as most of the federalist societies, they just want to tear down the republic itself.
And Mark, I think your points are all well taken. There's no doubt that you and many, many other people in the face of this planet, including the United States of America here, very, very critical of this decision. I include myself in that category. People looking at this, in addition to it being just fairly poorly written, pursuing these positions without understanding fundamental notions about how the Department of Justice works, this notion that somehow you could continue with an assessment of the extent to which our national security has been compromised, but not pursue the criminal investigation, dividing that up, which is a core function of the Department of Justice and one of the reasons why they're appealing this. The importance, as Mark, you just indicated, don't have to be a lawyer, can be an accountant, can be many other things in America to understand the reasons why. When it comes to an investigation like this, the Department of Justice, not without question down the road, but needs to have the latitude, the discretion to make these informed decisions about how investigations proceed. So points all well taken. And again, on Constitution Day, especially significant to make that understanding and make those comments, Mark. So we appreciate your observations here this morning. Dan from Monona also calling in. Dan, your thoughts, comments about this issue or others?
Yeah, I was curious if Cannon's crazy positions are allowed to stand, could they be used in future cases as precedent? Let me know how ignorant they sound.
Sure, no, not one bit. Dan, the importance of a precedent cannot be overstated. And so, just like Mark, I don't have to be a lawyer to understand these things. The answer is that as this moves up to the courts, the 11th Circuit, obviously, if they make some decisions that we don't anticipate, again, most people, I think, regard the 11th Circuit. It is a split circuit in terms of its political bent, if you will. You'd like to think that judges do not have any political bent, but they do have a little bit of that history, if you will, about it's a 12-person court, about half of them appointed by Republicans, half appointed by Democrats, shouldn't have an impact in the end. But whatever they decide, whatever the 3-judge panel of those 11 of the 12 judges, whatever they decide would have precedential value in the 11th Circuit in those 3 states, Alabama, Georgia, and Florida. It is anticipated that depending upon upon how quickly they move, and they should move fairly quickly. I'm sure the Department of Justice will move the judges there as quickly as possible. Should be sending the message that this kind of decision in the South Florida district is not supported by the law. The department does have the capacity, the right under the Constitution, under laws, to pursue this investigation as it should. Anticipating that this 11th Circuit, which is a justice-based, rule-of-law-based circuit, as they all are, should do that. And that will have, Dan, precedential value in the 11th Circuit. It's also the case that other circuits can look to that and also say, you know what, we also have precedent. We are here in the 7th Circuit. It's Indiana, it's Illinois, and Wisconsin. 7th Circuit can look to the 11th Circuit and say that's also guiding law, a very important point to make. So good important point, Dan. Yeah, go ahead.
I was also wondering, her rulings are so off the wall. What are the chances of the DOJ maybe looking into her, watching her, or tapping her phone or anything? You know.
Right. Well, again, we like to think that would not happen unless, again, there's probable cause. You've got probable cause to believe that there's a crime of some kind. We live in a country, as you well appreciate, Dan and others, that we don't initiate investigations because we don't like somebody's decision. We may not like them, and we disagree with them. The remedy, what is to do what? It's to appeal, right? And to go to the public domain, as you're just discussing, Dan, to talk about the reasons why in America we've got this capacity to chat about things that our government does that we disagree with. We don't go down the road of investigating individuals without some probable cause, some reason to believe that there is a crime there. But Dan, your point, your comment here, especially appropriate because we're going to spend some time in the second portion of our time together this morning talking about a violation of fundamentally that principle, that notion that we will use the Department of Justice for political purposes, and we're going to discuss that more. The limits, the appropriate limits on the Department of Justice and the notion that everything that it does and everything that federal judges do should be guided by the rule of law, not influenced by politics, by partisan perspectives. So we appreciate your comments, Dan. Very well taken. Important to move our discussion along here as well. Final comment or so just about what's happening here. Let's talk a little bit about the arbiter, if you will, the special master she's appointed. His name is Raymond Deary. He is 78 years old. He was officially appointed by Judge Cannon to do this review process. It's a very broad commission, giving him powers to review these materials, again, seized from Mar-a-Lago, the residence, the private club. He is going to be looking for attorney-client privilege in a fairly routine measure, an activity and undertaking already pretty much done by this filter review team that was already authorized by the court. But nonetheless, we're going to do this again, if you will, based upon Judge Cannon's directive that this Judge Deary now undertake this. He's going to separate out those that may be shielded by executive privilege as well. Sort of a strange, much more unusual move in criminal cases, the kind of thing that's not normally embraced and pursued absent some initiation of criminal cases. So he is out there looking at all of this and also making determinations about whether or not, as Judge Cannon said, there should be some prompt adjustments, her words, not mine, to the court's orders as necessary. So plainly, she's vesting in him some authority to look at all of this and get back to her about whether or not there need to be some adjustments in what she has said. But in the meantime, much of the investigation and indeed the review of the extent to which this has affected our national security remains on hold. Judge Deary, as we all well know, again, formerly a part of the federal judiciary, he is now on senior status, native of Long Island, got his start in 1969 with a law firm in New York. 2 years later, left private practice, began his federal career, joined the U.S. Attorney's Office in Brooklyn. He rose through the ranks there. He was appointed to be U.S. Attorney in 1982 by Ronald Reagan. Chief federal prosecutor there, he made cases against gangsters from New York's five mafia families, international drug dealer prosecutions, and earned this reputation, which is being talked about a lot today as being a sort of a by-the-book kind of law enforcement official. In 1986, Alphonse D'Amato, then a Republican in the United States Senate from New York, nominated him to be a federal district court judge, and he has held that position for 36
years. So bring a lot of reputation. Also was a part of the FISA court, this court that reviews petitions in especially sensitive matters having to do with the investigation of international matters and, again, our national security. The Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Court served on that from 2012 to 2017. So brings a lot of good background to this important task, even though, once again, the Court of Appeals now having before it not the appointment of him, but the decision not to permit the investigation to go forward. Big news coming out of the Department of Justice just last night. We'll talk more about that, take your phone calls, and then move on to other issues as Morning Cannolis continues on September 17th, 2022. Final moments of our first hour here, Saturday, September 17th, Morning Cannolis. We're spending most of our first hour talking about this breaking news coming out of Washington, D.C., coming out of South Florida, the United States Department of Justice appealing a portion of Judge Eileen Cannon's order, directing that the investigation of the classified documents, the pursuit of them, the effort by the Department of Justice to determine whether there has been a crime committed here, that be suspended until the special master, whom she's appointed, conducts its review. The Department of Justice last night filing an appeal of that portion of the order, not objecting to the appointment of the special master, this arbiter that we have talked about, this Judge Raymond Deary, well qualified to do this very important task, but nonetheless asking the Court of Appeals to overturn Judge Cannon's decision, preventing them from going ahead to investigate further. We know as well that Judge Deary has already jumped into the role. He has indicated that both the attorneys for Mr. Trump, the former president, and lawyers for the Department of Justice send to him some proposed agenda items as early as this coming Monday before an initial meeting with them this coming week on Tuesday. He's going to be doing all this out of a federal courthouse in Brooklyn. In Brooklyn is where Judge Deary is going to be undertaking this. He's got a deadline of November 30th to complete this task. In the meantime, again, a court of appeals is going to be looking at whether or not that all of that processing should be suspended or if, in fact, the decision by Eileen Cannon should be reversed. Gene from Eau Claire, you're calling in to, again, provide a question, a comment, a thought about our discussion this morning. Thanks so much. Gene, your comment.
First of all, thank you so much for the education. I got my paper and pen. I feel like I'm in school again.
Very
this
good.
Is just outstanding. Done very well, and you're teaching us a lot of information. However, you know, I have some hope with this appointment of this judge. I have a little bit of security with his immediately calling both sides in to talk to him about what's going to happen and what their expectations and things. But I'm still concerned about this judge that continues to hold on to this case. And I'm wondering who is critiquing or overseeing the federal judges. I don't want to distract, but maybe in the future, is there any protections, you know, for the United States from judges that take this kind of slant or this kind of position that really do harm the people, and if there's any oversight? And that's my question. Thank you so much. And if you need to do that at a different time, that's fine too, but I hope in the future you can address that because that's concerning to me. Thank you.
Absolutely. Gina, I appreciate the comment. I appreciate the support and what we're trying to do here on Morning Cannolis, doing some education, hopefully not partisan, not political, but nonetheless providing information that helps everybody think critically
Gene, as you just said, and I cannot tell you how significant your question, your comment is, because in fact, I was going to spend the last few moments talking about that very issue. What kinds of things can citizens, including parties in civil cases, criminal cases, do when they are dissatisfied with our federal judiciary? And what is the role? What is the role, even of something called the Administrative Office of U.S. Courts? What is the role, most importantly, of the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court? Because there's another issue that came out, another story just this past week. And so, in partial answer to your question, Gene, very, very well stated. Of course, you can appeal. That is the best way of addressing what you feel is an accomplishment, if you will, of injustice, a bad decision. That is very public, as we're seeing just last night and this morning, as the United States Department of Justice does that. That happens all the time. It's the reason why we have, if you will, even inside the judiciary, this check and balance. No single federal judge on his or her own, with the exception of the 9 Supreme Court justices, as we all know, has the right to make an ultimate decision. If, in fact, you're dissatisfied by a district court judge in Milwaukee, in Chicago, in San Francisco, in Boston, in South Florida, you appeal to the federal appeals court. And again, in our area, it's the 7th Circuit. In those southern states, it's the 11th Circuit. So you can do that. But there's also other avenues for addressing the kind of thing, Gene, that you're complaining about, I think, most appropriately. When you see a judge whose actions, whose behavior may be contrary to the rule of law. Again, we don't pursue criminal investigations of those individuals, absent to believe there's been a crime committed. But as I indicated, the Chief Justice of the United States Supreme Court, right now John Roberts, does have duties and responsibilities, as does the Administrative Office of U.S. Courts, to provide oversight and direction. And there are guidelines and there are rules and regulations for the conduct of federal judges at the district court level, at the appeals court level as well. And so, not unusual, in ways that probably are not public, unlikely that we will ever know about the Chief Justice or others reaching into a court of appeals, reaching out to a district court judge and talking with them about their conduct, their behavior, that kind of thing. But we know from history that those kinds of things can, in fact, happen. And the Chief Justice, by virtue of the fact that he is in charge of this administrative office of U.S. courts, is also the boss, if you will, of judiciary. And so he's got this great responsibility. And indeed, Gene, your question is so very appropriate, because just this past week, both the Chief Justice and Associate Justice Elena Kagan commented, if you will, about these kinds of things. The Chief Justice said, that controversial decisions should not lead to questions about the legitimacy of the Supreme Court. That was the Chief Justice commenting, presumably, about all the criticism coming to the Supreme Court about decisions, for example, in Dobbs and Bruin, the guns case, other cases it's decided this past year, just these past months. Even more importantly, listen to what Justice Elena Kagan said, Jean, to your very, very point. She said this, at least this is how the media is reporting on it. She said, I think judges create legitimacy problems for themselves, undermine their legitimacy when they don't act so much like courts and when they don't do things that are recognizably law, and when they instead stray into places where it looks like they are an extension of the political process or where they are imposing their own personal preferences. Let me repeat some of the creating legitimacy problems themselves when they're not acting like courts, undermining their legitimacy when they're not doing law and straying into places of political focus, a political process, imposing their own personal references and preferences. So that's Associate Justice Elena Kagan commenting about judges. Now, not specifically talking about Eileen Cannon, but probably responding to the entire world right now, the entire nation right now, looking at the U.S. Supreme Court and its decisions, and yes, now focusing, as Gene and you and others this morning, Mark and Don, have done, focusing on this particular district court judge who may in fact be
running afoul of what Justice Elena Kagan has commissioned out there. We're going to talk more about ways in which the judiciary should be acting properly, in which the Department of Justice should be acting in our second hour this morning on Morning Cannolis. Continue. Stay with us. Again, your calls always accepted, always, always encouraged as we talk this morning about the aspiration for justice in America, law, and government. Continue with us.
Welcome. Grab your favorite morning beverage and join us for Morning Cannolis with Jim Santel.
You don't know me, but I'm your brother.
Sampling the news desserts of the week, here is your host, Jim Santel.
This is Morning Cannolis, and this is Jim Santel talking with you again this morning about the aspiration for justice in America, law, government issues. We spent most of our first hour chatting about the recent developments in South Florida, the decision by the United States Department of Justice to appeal Judge Eileen Cannon's decision, imposing upon the Department of Justice the restriction with respect to its review, its analysis, its national security review of these 100 classified documents seized during the course of the search and seizure of Donald Trump's residence, his resort in Mar-a-Lago in early August. That now in front of the Court of Appeals. They will hopefully work on this expeditiously. No specific schedule for that to be done, but the Department of Justice is certainly going to be pursuing this aggressively and attempting as best it can to obtain a fairly prompt decision on the legitimacy of Judge Cannon's order. Also along the way, obviously, continuing to work at the district court level and engage with the new arbiter, the fellow who has been appointed, this former district judge, who is now going to be reviewing these documents according to Eileen Cannon's directive. So lots of activity going on there. I responded to Gene just before the break also, who is calling in to express concerns about checks and balances on judges, talked about appeals, obviously, that can be taken when you're dissatisfied with a decision of a judge. Also talked about the inherent authority of the Chief Justice to oversee the judges generally of the federal court. And the one that I did not specifically make reference to on this Constitution Day, September 17th, is something that comes right out of the Constitution, and that is the capacity to impeach judges. Very rarely done, but it has been done. The House of Representatives has brought charges against some federal sitting judges, both district court and appellate court judges, and has removed them after a trial in the Senate. Not very frequently done, but is also an available remedy in situations where the conduct of the judge is viewed by the House of Representatives, by the United States Congress, as so contrary to the rule of law that that particular individual, he or she, cannot continue in office. So there are remedies. There are remedies when one is confronted with decisions that are unfavorable or that to which you have objections. And in that connection, we're also taking your phone calls all morning as we move into other issues. But before we do that, let's take a couple of those additional phone calls calling in. We appreciate those tremendously. First, Joe from Madison. Joe, glad to have you with us again.
Terrific show, Jim. Lots of great information and great questions from your callers. I would like to add to this discussion. As I read some analysis of this appeal applied by the Department of Justice that just came out last night, it is said that some people regard this as something that you have referred to as almost a talking document, something that is meant to be understood easily by the public so that it can indicate kind of the serious, more easily accessible than some legalese might allow. And they refer to the fact that in the introduction, in the very first sentence, they use the language, and this is a direct quote, that they are concerned about the direct implications for national security. Wow. I mean, that's no fooling around.
It is not fooling around, right? Right? Absolutely. Go ahead.
Yeah. And And in the footnote, they refer to a case of national security that had to do with an individual. I'm messing up the pronunciation, but it's Ngao Pho. It's N-G-H-I-A, and then Pho is spelled P-H-O. In 2018, this individual released some classified information that was later used by a nefarious group called Shadow Brokers, and the loss of control over that classified information, they feel, led to some global malware attacks that were particularly grievous for all of us, not just us, but other people in other countries. So if you have this situation where in the very first sentence the DOJ is referring to the worry about national security, how does this get conveyed without specific examples to the judge that may be looking at this situation from the 11th Circuit? It just feels like you need to have specific examples of what they worried about is going to be betrayed, and how can you do that in just the appeal document, because the document is public. So I'd be curious, particularly with your background and what you did in Iraq and classified documents, how you, some speculation on your part as to how they indicate the seriousness of the national security risk to this judge in the 11th Circuit. Sure. Thanks for your always great insight. I'll listen to your thoughts off the air.
Joe, thanks so much for calling again this morning. Again, great thoughts. And yes, indeed, this is plainly intended, as Joe, you just indicated, not simply as a legalistic document for the judges of the 11th Circuit to take on. And certainly it has those trappings. There are certain things you have to say to invoke the jurisdiction of the appeals court, and that is plainly done here. But to your point, this kind of talking document that speaks not only to the judges, but also to the American public, so that all of us can understand it and appreciate the seriousness. Undeniably, that's what Merrick Garland is doing here, to let us know. Also, along the same lines of agreeing to release significant portions of the underlying affidavit supporting this search in itself from the very start. That's an atypical thing to do. Why is it being done? Because the American public, the attorney general feels strongly, should have some sense of what's going on here. We see that again, Joe, in what you've just read. The challenge, of course, is to do all of this in a public domain, but also ensure, as your question indicates, that the safe safety and security of our nation is not compromised. We're talking about 100 documents. They're classified. Those cannot be in the public filings. You're absolutely right, Joe. Those cannot be out there for you and me to consume. Only people with appropriate clearances can look at those. And indeed, that's one of the challenges now with the special master on this. He has got to get clearance to have him have access to all these documents. It will be interesting to see in wrestling with exactly the issue that you just identified. How do you impress upon the judges? And by the way, it will be a three-judge panel, actually three judges out of the present, that's 11 out of 12. Three judges will be looking at this, and so they're randomly selected. How do you take a look at this case and not simply rely upon the important and compelling, and I'd offer reliable statements, that this does potentially compromise our national security? It is entirely possible that the circuit court judges, like the district court judge, like the magistrate judge, could do an in-camera review, take a look at some of these documents that are also a part of the record already in this matter. No doubt the federal judiciary has them, has taken a look at that. You can make that submission to them and say, this is a sampling, if you will, or this is all 100 of them. And this is the reason why this cannot, we've got to go ahead quickly and make that showing. That's one option that could be available to them. I'm sure they're considering it. Beyond that, they simply invoke, as you did, Joe, some of the traditions, some of the precedent here that that underscores the importance of this and the reason why we can't simply wait. Can't simply wait, even after the special master here does his work. Can't wait on this. Lives are at stake. The security and the national security of our country also at stake. So some options for getting that in front of the appeals court judges, the three-judge panel. We'll find out presumably who they are fairly soon as this appeal goes forward. Great question. Great thought about this important procedure as this happens. Dick from Madison, you're also calling in. Thanks for your call this morning.
Well, Jim, do you find it as hypocritical as I do for this former president and his followers that they're supposedly have owned law and order, you know, for all these years, and yet when they don't get their way, he advocates violence? I mean, the next thing I'm going to ask is, let's say Merrick Garland / the DOJ doesn't bring charges. we're seeing now that we're getting close to 60% of the country believe that he should be brought to justice. Don't you think we'll have problems the other way, too?
Sure.
I don't think we'll be violent about it, but I honestly think people will peacefully protest that type of a decision.
Right.
I certainly would.
Mm-hmm. Dick, and you, again, a point especially well made. I've made this comment before that, you know, a decision to prosecute for political reasons is as corrupt as it is as inappropriate as is a decision not to prosecute for political reasons, right? And so based upon that concept, if you will, America is watching, right? America is watching not just the case coming out of South Florida, but these other matters pending in other areas. Plainly, the Department of Justice looking through the grand jury at January 6th, the involvement of the former president and his senior staff. Also looking at other matters related to the conduct of that administration. And so investing in the attorney general, the authority, yes, to make those all-important decisions, investing in the authority of U.S. attorneys to make those decisions as well, very important. But who are they ultimately responsible to? You and me, right, Dick? We should call upon our elected officials to make decisions premised upon the law, but also to do it premised upon an understanding of what our nation's all about. And that law is, as we've talked this morning, it is accessible to all of us. It's not simply a lawyer thing or a judge thing. And so to your point about expecting from all sides of government, all branches of government, a legitimacy in their conduct cannot be overstated. So appreciate the comment, appreciate the call very much, Dick, this morning, which leads us into the other major topic I'm talking about this morning. And that is this fundamental notion about what the United States Department of Justice is all about and why that issue is back in front of the country in the wake of the publication by the former U.S. attorney in the District of New York, a fellow named Jeffrey Berman, who published a book released just this past week called Holding the Line. Before we get to that, let's talk more importantly about the relationship, as we've done before, between the Department of Justice and the presidency and the White House in particular. As I just indicated when Dick was calling in, we have got an expectation, all of us, as citizens of the United States of America, to expect from the Department of Justice legitimacy, upholding the statutes passed by the Congress, upholding the Constitution of the United States of America. And in doing all of that, one of the fundamental principles began with the first attorney general that George Washington appointed up through and including Merrick Garland. Every single attorney general commissioned by their oath of office to do that in a nonpartisan way, not premised upon politics, not premised upon what the docket of the Democratic Party or the Republican Party should be saying about a particular issue, doing it in a nonpartisan way, an apolitical way. Hugely important, and having an arm's length relationship with the presidency and the White House in particular. Before we go on too much further, I'll chat more about that right after the break. We're also going to talk about how that fundamental principle was violated during the course of the prior administration. Come back and talk more about all of those issues with us here on Morning Cannolis, talking about the relationship between the White House and the Department of Justice in America in 2022 and the years before. Come back right after the break. We're back once again. This is Morning Cannolis. We're talking in this second hour about the United States Department of Justice, much involved plainly in this appeal from Judge Cannon's decision out of South Florida, now to the 11th Circuit. We will look forward to some information, some reporting out of the 11th Circuit on what they do, that three-judge panel, in either upholding or perhaps much more likely overturning this Judge Cannon's decision to suspend the investigation with respect to these documents, 100 classified documents seized at Mar-a-Lago. We're talking more broadly now in this second hour about what the Department of Justice is all about and what its relationship to the White House should be. This all-important notion that any attorney general,
whether they are Republican appointed, Democratic appointed, should and must have an arm's length relationship with the White House. And we have seen that both observed and not observed in the past. I recall very well, I worked in the Janet Reno Department of Justice, that it is a part of history that she did not have an especially good relationship with her boss, the President of the United States of America, a fellow named Bill Clinton. Among other things, she appointed the Whitewater Special Counsel, a fellow named Ken Starr, who just passed away this past week, to investigate Whitewater. Obviously, the president didn't like that much, but she had the independence to do that. That resulted ultimately in the president's impeachment. Yes, his acquittal in the Senate. But nonetheless, that arm's length relationship that gives an attorney general the capacity to initiate investigation of the president himself or one day herself, that's the kind of independence that's all important. I would offer that the Clinton Reno relationship is a perfect example of what should happen here. I also worked, as you well know, in the Eric Holder administration under Barack Obama, who appointed me U.S. attorney. Likewise, an arm's length relationship there. I saw it firsthand. Decisions not being made because the White House wanted something done, not being made out of partisan approach or perspective, nothing premised upon politics, but upon what the rule of law dictates. This past week, this issue very much in the news once again because of what I would offer to be violations of that fundamental notion that should otherwise ensure that justice is properly administered in this nation. We have accounts provided by a former U.S. attorney under the Trump administration. His name is Jeffrey Berman. He was there for about 2.5 years until June of 2020, when, as you may recall, the President of the United States of America fired him, presumably for his failure to do what the president wanted him to do. I'm going to pull out three things that Jeffrey Berman has told us about this past week that underscores how not to do this relationship between the Department of Justice and the presidency of the United States of America. It involves two things that we knew about and a third that we never knew about before. All of them indicating in their example how not to engage with the Department of Justice as the White House did at that time and as White House going forward should do. I would offer under this administration, the Biden administration, plainly restoring that arm's length relationship, all important, giving Merrick Garland and his staff the latitude, the appropriate latitude, to make decisions that are not political. Let's talk about three things that Jeffrey Berman described for us this past week in his new book, one of them involving a fellow named Greg Craig. In March of 2018, very shortly after Mr. Berman became the U.S. attorney there, he was approached by Jeff Sessions, who at that time was the Attorney General of the United States of America, about the possibility of prosecuting Greg Craig. You may recall this from the news. The allegations at the time focused on whether Mr. Craig, who had been a White House counsel under Barack Obama, had concealed some work that he had done years earlier for the government of Ukraine, arguably in violation of something called the FARA, F-A-R-A, the Foreign Agents Registration Act. We've talked about that in the past, and whether he lied to the Department of Justice about it. And so after months of investigation of that, again, not in the public domain, nor should it have been. The Southern District and the Justice Department met with Mr. Craig's lawyers, and they discussed this. And Mr. Berman, that is a U.S. attorney, came away from that discussion with Greg Craig's lawyers believing that there was no case here, nothing to prosecute here, innocent of the FARA charge, and that a jury would be unlikely to convict him of false statements in a federal court. And that was a decision that the U.S. attorney made at that time. Short time after that, again in 2018, Mr. Berman's deputy, a fellow named Robert Kuzami, approached Mr. Berman, said he had gotten a call from a fellow named Edward O'Callaghan, who is the principal associate deputy attorney general, a thing we call the PADAG after the acronym, the principal associate deputy attorney general, a high-ranking official in the Department of Justice, saying that Mr. Berman, the U.S. attorney, should even things out.
even things out by charging Greg Craig before Election Day. And in that conversation, as Mr. Berman is telling us now, Mr. O'Callaghan apparently kept reminding the U.S. Attorney and the U.S. Attorney's Office that the Southern District had previously prosecuted two Republicans, a representative named Chris Collins from New York, and also a fellow named Michael Cohen, who you know well. Mr. Berman says he ignored that. He ignored what was being encouraged by Maine Justice to the Southern District of New York. And in mid-December, after that thorough investigation, Mr. Berman, the U.S. attorney there, informed the Department of Justice that he would decline to prosecute Mr. Craig. And he found out later that the department peddled the case then to the U.S. attorney in Washington, D.C., and Mr. Craig was eventually indicted and tried on a single count of making false statements. The proof is in the pudding. What happens after that? September 4th of 2019, Greg Craig, this fellow who was declined in prosecution by Jeff Berman, prosecuted by the U.S. Attorney's Office in Washington after pressure from the Department of Justice. What happens? He is acquitted. He is acquitted by a jury in less than 5 hours after the presentation of that case. His attorney says this was a case without evidence and without prejudice. The verdict felt like justice. Greg Craig should never have been prosecuted. That, according to the U.S. attorney, the former U.S. attorney, who decided initially not to prosecute, U.S. Department of Justice intervenes, pursues the prosecution to an unsuccessful prosecution and acquittal in the Federal District Court in the District of Columbia. Precisely the kind of thing you do not want the Department of Justice to be doing, having an influence, again, based upon this notion of evening the score, evening things out based upon criminal prosecutions of Republicans and Democrats. None of that. None of that should be the focus of what the Department and U.S. Attorney's offices should be all about. We've got a second instance involving Michael Cohen. Michael Cohen, as you know well, the former president's lawyer. And Mr. Berman again tells us this past week that he had to keep alive the prosecution of Mr. Cohen, again, in the wake of pressure by the U.S. Department of Justice, a prosecution that ultimately led to the Mr. Cohen pleading guilty to campaign violations before the 2016 election. We'll talk more about that right after the break. And another instance of engagement by the Department of Justice influencing in a partisan way the actions of the U.S. Attorney's Office attempting to do so. Stay with us as we talk more about these disclosures coming out just this past week. Welcome back to Morning Cannolis. This is Jim Santel. Our last half an hour this morning, we are talking in this hour about the all-important notion that the United States Department of Justice, the Attorney General, all of the political appointees, all of the civil servants of the United States Department of Justice need to be doing their work and should be doing their work, are commissioned, are given an oath of office to do that work without political interference in an apartisan, non-political way. And we're chatting in particular about revelations made just this past week by the former U.S. attorney in Southern New York, Southern District of New York, a fellow named Jeffrey Berman, who's describing these instances in which under the prior administration, under Bill Barr, prior administration, also of Jeffrey Sessions, his office and he in particular pressured to do things for political purposes, undermining, taking back and pulling back this fundamental centuries-long relationship between the White House and the Department of Justice, arm's length. Reviewing cases and suggesting to the U.S. attorney there that he and his staff should pursue prosecutions, not pursue prosecutions, all kinds of things that are wildly inappropriate. Right before the break, we talked about this instance involving the former a lawyer named Greg Craig, who was involved White House counsel under President Barack Obama, and the failed attempt to prosecute him successfully. He was acquitted of making false statements to the FBI. Right before the break, I was beginning to talk about another instance in which this line, this appropriate line between the White House
and the Department of Justice, and the Department of Justice and Maine Justice and U.S. Attorney's offices was also being crossed. We know well about Michael Cohen. He was the president, the former president's lawyer. And we know well that he pleaded guilty way back in 2018 to some campaign finance violations. You recall well this had to do with his payments that he had arranged before the 2016 election to keep a couple of women from disclosing affairs they had with Mr. Trump, sometimes called the catch and kill problem. Jeff Berman reports that he didn't participate in that investigation, but he does recount that before the plea, before Michael Cohen pled guilty to this very publicly, you may recall as well that there was a charging document prepared, an indictment that set forth the crimes that Michael Cohen had engaged in. And during the course of that, in that talking indictment, there was specific reference to an individual number one, an individual number one in quotes. Undeniably, the sitting president of the United States of America, who is involved in this process, this attempt to try to prevent these women from talking publicly about the affairs right before the 2016 election. And Mr. Berman now tells us that prior to that plea, prior to that document being released, the Southern District, of course, continued to pursue investigations into possible campaign violations, including other people in Mr. Trump's orbit. But after Bill Barr became the attorney general in 2019, apparently, according to the U.S. attorney, the attorney general, Mr. Barr, reached out to kill those investigations and suggested Mr. Cohen's conviction on campaign finance charges likewise be reversed, even though about 6 months or so had passed since Mr. Cohen had entered that guilty plea. And requests made then by the attorney general, by Bill Barr, to justify what had happened under the Cohen prosecution, attempts to try to justify that successful because in the end, the Department of Justice was convinced, apparently, by Mr. Berman that the prosecution was legitimate, even though the Department of Justice was trying to push back on that prosecution. Along the way, Justice Department officials trying to get, even before the prosecution happened, trying to get this document, this charging document with respect to Michael Cohen, purged of, removed references to this individual number one, all references to the sitting document, also unsuccessful. But another instance that Jeffrey Berman accounts of this inappropriate relationship between the White House and Maine Justice and the U.S. Attorney's Office during his term as the U.S. Attorney. We knew something about those because they were somewhat in the public domain. Here's a third instance, which Jeffrey Berman now recounts as well. We didn't know a lot about this, if anything at all. We know as well that during the course of this time, when Mr. Berman was the U.S. Attorney, that the Southern District of New York had reached a conclusion that there was nothing to pursue with respect to John Kerry. That's right, John Kerry. There were efforts made through the president's verbal statements in the public domain about whether or not John Kerry should be investigated by the Department of Justice for what the president described as being very, very things very bad. Advice by John Kerry. He tweeted on the morning of April 22nd, perhaps a big violation of the Logan Act. The Logan Act, all this coming out from the president's tweets with respect to John Kerry during the course of the president's presidency. And the former U.S. attorney, Berman, says that one of his chiefs in charge of the Southern District's National Security Unit got a call from the Justice Department asking why the Southern District of New York was delaying seeking an order to review some of the dates and the recipients and the senders of John Kerry's electronic communications. Why isn't there more of an investigation going on there? And this more senior official pressed the issue again the next day, also with officials out of the Southern District of New York. And Jeff Berman says that the pattern was clear.
it was outrageous, and that the investigation began after Mr. Trump started tweeting his displeasure about John Kerry. A new tweet 11 months after of prompted some further prodding of this investigation. They were basically asking, according to Jeff Byrne, why is this taking so long? Why aren't you going harder and faster at this enemy of the president? There was no other way to look at it, Jeff Byrne described it. Mr. Berman said that after an investigation of roughly a year, again, not in the public domain, the office, the U.S. Attorney's Office, found out that there was no basis for doing it, no basis to prosecute Mr. Kerry for anything that the president and even Maine Justice was advocating for. And that after that, in about September of 2019, a senior advisor to the Attorney General called to say that the Attorney General expected that the Kerry case would be going to another U.S. Attorney's Office, this time in Maryland. That office, thankfully, resulted in the same conclusion as the Southern District of New York, that there was nothing here to investigate, and the investigation died, as it should have. Mr. Berman said that this was just yet another attempt to prosecute another enemy of the president, and Mr. Berman said that he hoped the verdict would ease pressure. That is the Greg Craig verdict and the other things he had done, eased verdict on the U.S. Attorney's Office in Southern New York to pursue John Kerry. John Kerry not prosecuted, but Jeff Berman saying in the end, it was a naive on his part to assume that the Greg Craig failed prosecution would prevent the Department of Justice from pursuing even further prosecutions against people like John Kerry. All of these accounts involving Greg Craig, involving Michael Cohen, involving John Kerry, recounted this week as instances in which the United States Department of Justice doing the bidding of the President of the United States of America to try to get prosecutions either stopped or started based upon what? Based upon political animus, based upon partisan reasons. Again, a complete undermining of the relationship, a revelation about what was going on in the past administration under the administrations of Jeff Sessions, the former Attorney General, under also the administration of Bill Barr. Again, this is not a promotion for Jeff Berman's book. It is nonetheless a recitation, if you will, of three of these major accounts that we're seeing this past week coming out of those accountings provided by the former U.S. attorney that reveal that during a significant portion of the prior administration, there was not this arm's length relationship between the Department of Justice and U.S. Attorney's Office, appropriately described as being independent of partisan influence, independent of political influence, not happening during this prior administration, and reasons for concern about the future. If, in fact, the Department of Justice is inhabited by a future attorney general who takes the same approach, that he is not independent of the White House and should pressure future U.S. attorneys to do things like this, we could see this revisited. And so very important to understand this history now recounted by Jeff Berman, the former U.S. attorney in Southern New York. During the course of his recitation, he talks about not only his naivete, but also about during the time that he was in the U.S. Attorney's Office, that he felt repeated pressure to do things on behalf of the presidency without evidence, without purpose, and without justification in the law. Very important to understand these overtly political demands, as Jeff Berman describes them, choosing targets that he said would further advance President Trump's desires for what he described as revenge and advantage. Jeff Berman writing that pressure was clearly inspired by the president's openly professed wants and interests, exactly what you do not want the Department of Justice to be all about as you go forward in the pursuit of justice and the pursuit of the rule of law in behalf of Americans. We're going to talk more about this in our final segment this morning as we chat about one other thing that's coming out this past week as the investigation, the pursuit of what's called the John Durham investigation begins to come to a conclusion here in the United States of America. One more case yet to be resolved in October. I'm going to talk about, again, the involvement of the Department of Justice to do the bidding, if you will, of a former president using the Department of Justice to advance an inappropriate agenda, this time to pursue the Russia investigation to determine whether or not the investigation of Russian involvement in the 2016 election was justified at all. We'll chat more about the genesis of that, the status right now of this John Durham special counsel investigation, and why it is yet another example of the importance of an arm's length relationship between the White House, between the Department of Justice and U.S. attorneys, and the prosecutions under the rule of law in America. So join us right after for this continuing discussion of all these important issues right after the break. Coming up here on Morning Cannolis, as always, taking your phone calls, your comments, your questions here at 844-967-2789 as we continue this discussion this morning about the rule of law in America. Was in fact obstruction of justice in that very pursuit of that investigation. As Robert Mueller was beginning to wrap that up, we know well that Bill Barr decided to appoint John Durham, a fellow named John Durham, who at that time was the United States Attorney in Connecticut, again, serving under the Trump administration, properly appointed, nominated by the president, confirmed by the Senate, to review the FBI's Russia probe itself. This is basically an investigation of the investigation to determine whether or not there was legitimacy to it. And I should note that the Durham investigation, which continues to this day, even under this next administration, under the administration of Merrick Garland, has actually gone on longer than the underlying Trump-Russia investigation itself. But we know that in the wake of that initial appointment, John Durham and his staff, first as U.S. attorney, then as special counsel, Bill Barr sort of upgraded his status shortly before the 2020 election. That was a decision that probably made it harder for the incoming Biden administration to shut down this team that was looking at this. And in fact, Merrick Garland, to his credit, has not shut it down. He's let this investigation continue despite complaints from many people about its lack of productivity, about the findings and its results to date, which aren't much to look at. Durham's team, for what it's worth, has spent about $4.5 million since October of 2020, according to the Justice Department itself. And those results have produced this 3-year inquiry far below the sort of sky-high expectations set publicly by the president, the former president, who had tweeted long ago that this long-running probe would in fact produce Watergate-caliber indictments against Clinton loyalists and would also reveal this deep state. President Trump had tweeted that the Durham investigation would uncover the crime of the century, in his words. And just last month, he said that this Durham report that's forthcoming would expose corruption at a high level never before seen in our country. Well, in fact, we know what has happened to date in this investigation. John Durham still in that position, but plainly, this investigative initiative winding down somewhat. During the time of this investigation to date, the former U.S. attorney, John Durham, has prosecuted three people. One of them, named Igor Denshenko, and we'll talk a little bit more about him in just a moment or so ago. He is actually going to trial next month in October. We'll talk about the problems with that particular prosecution. There were two other prosecutions also that came out of this Durham investigation. One of them was with respect to a lawyer named Michael Sussman. Michael Sussman, remember this particular story? He was acquitted, ultimately, of charges brought by John Durham about lying to the FBI about who his client was. Mr. Sussman had come forward, spoken to the FBI, providing some information about supposed ties between the Trump administration and Russia. Again, not proven, not shown by the Mueller investigation itself. But during the course of that, the FBI allegedly lied to by Mr. Sussman. What happens during the course of that is that Mr. Sussman, again, goes to trial. Just like Greg Craig in the other instance we talked about, Mr. Sussman is found not guilty of making false representations to the FBI during the course of that interview. The second prosecution, sort of a mid-level lawyer named Kevin Kleinsmith, who pled guilty in 2020 to doing what? To doctoring an email in 2017 that the FBI had used to support the surveillance of a former Trump campaign aide. So that prosecution results in a plea of guilty following the acquittal of Michael Sussman. And there's a third prosecution, a fellow named Igor Danchenko. And the focus of that particular case, again, going to trial next month, is that Danchenko was one of these fellows who apparently contributed heavily to the Steele dossier. Remember this sort of now discredited attempt to establish Donald Trump's supposed cooperation with the Russian government. Steele had said that the dossier was raw intelligence. The indictment against Danchenko, this Igor Danchenko, accused him of lying to the FBI about contacts with a fellow named Sergey Milian, sort of an enigmatic businessman who once did some real estate work with the Trump organization. And a successful prosecution of Danchenko, now scheduled for trial, would be boosted, obviously, by the testimony of this fellow named Milian, who has publicly stated that he never met with or communicated with Danchenko, has no ties to him. And the significance of that is that in a recent filing, in connection with this Danchenko prosecution, the Durham Group has said that despite its best efforts, the government's attempts to secure Milian's voluntary testimony have been unsuccessful. They could not serve a trial subpoena on him and don't even know his address. All of that according to filings made in the federal district court in anticipation next month of this prosecution. Again, the prosecution based upon Danchenko's arguably having falsely stated that he believed that he spoke on the phone with Milian in July of 2016 and the Trump campaign was colluding with the Russian government. Again, Milian saying that never happened. And Durham, in a recent court filing, saying that Danchenko had fabricated those facts regarding Milian. That's the basis of the prosecution. The challenge with it, again, going forward, is that Milian not being able to be presented in this trial, don't know where he is, can't secure his presence. And so we know that those are the three cases brought by this Durham prosecution, plainly coming to its end. And all of this in an attempt to try to undermine, if you will, the legitimacy of the Mueller investigation initiated by the former Attorney General Bill Barr, commissioning John Durham to do this, resulting in an acquittal, resulting in one plea of guilty, and a very uncertain trial coming up in October. Whether that will go ahead or not, we will remain to be seen as John Durham is beginning to wrap up his investigation of all of this. Cited this past week, again, as the Department of Justice, through John Durham, files these reports with the federal court about the case going forward or not. And again, looking in October of this year to determine whether or not that particular trial coming out of this investigation has any legs. Scheduled upcoming trial against this so-called Russian expat set to go for a federal district court judge in Alexandria, Virginia. We're about 4 weeks out on that case, and we'll see whether or not that produces anything. We also know just this past week that one of the Durham's top prosecutors, a fellow named Andrew DeFilippis, who had led this team's case against Hillary Clinton's campaign lawyer early this year, which we talked about previously. He is supposedly stepping down, leaving the Department of Justice for a private law firm. He said in a recent months he's working on a report to summarize the Durham investigation. He is now departing that group. Again, as this investigation begins to wind down to an end. Again, why do I raise all these kinds of stories today? Why do we look to the relationship and these issues about the relationship between the former president and attempts to undermine the Department of Justice in its legitimate work, and also to use the Department of Justice to suggest that prior prosecutions, including the Mueller investigation, were not properly founded, goes to this fundamental issue about the rule of law in America, the importance of independence of prosecutions, civil and criminal, along the way. We'll talk more about that next week and invite you to come back for more Morning Cannolis next week as we talk more about justice, the aspiration for it, America, law and government. Join us then. Thank you so much for joining me this morning. Jim Santel, Morning Cannolis on WAUK Radio in Waukesha, Wisconsin.
You are listening to WAUK 540 AM Jackson, W226 DR Waukesha, always streaming at WAUKRadio.com. If you think you need a home inspection, you probably do. Hi, I'm Todd Osborne of Orion Inspections. And buyers, sellers, and even flippers, I'm talking to you. Knowledge is power when it comes to real estate transactions. You'll get an image-packed, searchable, digital, printable report of the condition of the house, things to keep an eye on, any safety issues or defects, and the knowledge to make smart, informed decisions. Your instinct is telling you to get an inspection, and instincts are usually right. Learn more or schedule today at orioninspections.com.
Hi, everyone. Listen to my show, The Matt McNeil Show, weekday afternoons at 3 p.m. on the Shaw 101. 1 hour every weekday where we'll talk all sorts of things like politics, especially with what's going on this election season, plus a lot of other things, too. Parenting, the arts, religion, music, beer. If it matters to Wisconsin and Minnesota, we'll talk about it. Phone calls are welcome at 952-946-6205 for 1 hour each day. Come see the train chimp, The Matt McNeil Show, with the aggressive progressive Matt McNeil, 3 p.m. weekday afternoons right here on the Shaw 101.
So all you folks out there, if you haven't registered to vote, register to vote. Get ready to vote. There are so many things on the ballot this November, at our freedom, our liberty, and our way of life. But we'll get to all of that this evening.
The Paul Revere Show with Mark Thompson. Listen Monday, 7 to 8 p.m. on the Shaw 101 FM and WAUK 540 AM.
Ahoo, this is Robert Pilot of Native Roots Radio Presents I'm Awake. On our show, we talk about Native issues like treaty violations, protecting the water, and COVID in our Native communities. Native issues are human issues, and human issues are Native issues. We invite all people to walk hand in hand with us through our struggles, victories, and achievements. Join us weeknights from 6 to 7 p.m. Alliant Energy is a proud sponsor of Native Roots Radio.
Hey, this is Matt from Design Garden. Remember when the internet was new? Back then, you had to leave your house to start a business. Companies used to pay programmers bags of cash to get online. Now, small businesses can get online with a Facebook business page, or Squarespace, or Google My Business, or WordPress. But which tools should you use? Can you afford to go down the wrong path? Design Garden uses modern tools to build your website the right way. Find us online at design.garden. Again, that's design.garden.
Olivia, from Washington. Laid off and trying to keep our little kids from realizing that mommy and daddy haven't eaten in a while.
Roger, from California. I'm grateful we could afford our son's surgery. I'm nervous that now we can't really afford food.
Daniel, from California. Choosing whether to pay the rent or pay to fix the car to get to work doesn't leave us with much at all. Now we can't even pay for meals.
Donna from Louisiana. The storm just hit, and we went from donating to the food bank to needing it.
Keisha from South Carolina. I've been skipping meals so my two kids can eat, but filling up on water doesn't really work.
Hunger is a story we can end. End it at feedingamerica.org. Brought to you by Feeding America and the Ad Council.
19, brought to you by CDC and the Ad Council.
With so much loss, you may feel like you can't handle it all. Meditation or other spiritual practices can help you feel more grounded and better able to cope.
Find more self-care and coping tips at coping-19.org.
1 in 3 adults has prediabetes. 1 in 3. That means it could be you, your football buddy. Your football buddy. Or you, your best man. Your worst man. You, your dog walker. Your cat jogger. While 1 in 3 adults has prediabetes, with early diagnosis, prediabetes can be reversed. Take the risk test at doihaveprediabetes.org. Brought to you by the Ad Council and its prediabetes awareness partners.
What I know about courage, I learned from my adoptive mom. She said sometimes you just gotta hold on and know we'll get through this. Mom, we are so high up. Hold my hand.
No, you hold my hand.
Here we go.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more.
I learned patience from my adoptive dad. All he had to say was,
"Hey, you got this. Just breathe." Hey, we're pretty good.
Yeah.
Might have to start a band.
I got it.
Learn about adopting a teen from foster care. You can't imagine the reward. Visit AdoptUSKids.org to find out more. This message is brought to you by AdoptUSKids, the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and the Ad Council.
I love this song!
I love nachos.
Loving everything? You might be buzzed.
You know what I'd love? A ride when it's time to head out.
If you see a buzz warning sign, call for a ride when it's time to go home. Buzz driving is drunk driving. A message from NHTSA and the Ad Council.
Excuse me, pardon?
Getting lost in a city you always wanted to visit.
Pardon, madame. Pardon? See...